Good morning and welcome to the third meeting in 2023 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee, and we've had apologies from committee member Marie McNair. I remind all members and witnesses to ensure that their devices are on silent and all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. And the first item on our agenda today is to decide whether to take items 4, 5 and 6 in private. Are members agreed? We're all agreed. Thank you. We now turn to agenda item 2, which is to take evidence from two panels of witnesses on local government fiscal arrangements. The first session will focus on the recently published Accounts Commission's Financial Bulletin 2021-22. Our first panel today, we are joined by Bill Moyes, who's the chair, and Andrew Burns is a member of the Accounts Commission. Welcome. And also, they are accompanied today by Carol Calder, who's the Audit Director, and Blythe Deans, who's Senior Manager at Audit Scotland. And I welcome our witnesses to the meeting. And before we open up to questions from members, I now invite Bill to make a short opening statement.
Well, Chairwoman, thank you very much indeed. And on behalf of my colleagues on the Commission, let me just say that I welcome the opportunity to discuss with the committee the financial bulletin that we published recently. The Financial Bulletin, which was published in January, gives an independent assessment of Council's financial performance during 2021-22. And the Bulletin sets out the increasingly uncertain, complex and challenging context in which Councils are operating and the strain on budgets that continues to intensify. Councils across Scotland faced significant financial challenges during 2021-22. And are now entering the most difficult budget-setting context seen for many years. Increasingly difficult choices about spending priorities will have to be made. Even with the additional COVID-19 funding during 21-22, councils had to make significant savings to balance their budgets. Many councils have also used reserves to bridge funding gaps and fund vital services. When compared to 2013-14, Scottish Government revenue funding to local government in 21-22 represented the first real terms increase in 6 years, if you exclude one-off COVID-19 money. But an increasing amount of council funding is either formally ring-fenced or provided on the expectation that it will be spent on specific services and national policy objectives. This ring-fencing or directing of funds supports the delivery of key Scottish Government policies, but it removes local discretion and flexibility over how these funds can be used by councils to address local priorities. Two-thirds of councils intend to use reserves to help bridge the 22-23 budget gap. However, the use of non-recurring reserves or the reliance on non-recurring savings is not financially sustainable in the medium to longer term, in our view. The achievement of recurring savings and a movement away from the reliance and use of non-recurring reserves will be key to ensuring longer-term financial sustainability. This makes the case for a continued focus on service reform based on strong engagement with communities is now more important than ever. For 23-24, the Scottish Government announced £570 million of additional funding in December of last year. And this is expected to help councils address upcoming cost challenges. However, with the scale of inflationary pressures, further change and reform across all councils is required to ensure longer-term financial sustainability. Councils have also noted that COVID-19 and inflationary costs are having an impact on capital projects. If these issues persist, they will present risks to councils' capital programmes, which form a necessary component of modernising services to deliver improved outcomes for local communities. Thank you very much for listening to me. I'm now happy to take questions with my colleagues. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Bill. I'm going to open up with the initial questions. And you touched on a little bit, but we'd love to get a little bit more details. So the committee is keen to understand the 2023 to 2024 budget impacts on local government. And the Commission, in your financial bulletin, notes the government's position that the settlement sees a cash increase of £570 million, which you just mentioned in your statement. But it also acknowledges, your bulletin also acknowledges causeless position that this is only around 70 million and now recently revised to 38 million once national policy commitments are taken into account. And we'd be interested to hear what the Accounts Commission's views are on these figures and how can both interpretations be correct?
Well, COVID funding has complicated the analysis of the availability of finance and spending patterns. Today, pretty much everything we will talk about will be on the basis that we have excluded COVID funding. We're dealing with core funding, because COVID funding was never meant to be a permanent part of funding local authorities. So if you exclude COVID funding, then the real terms increase is 5.3%. And I think that's the figure that we would rely on. But I'll ask my colleagues if they want to elaborate on that. No takers.
No takers. OK, well, that's helpful. So it's the COVID funding piece is the part of that. I think we'd also be interested to hear what the Commission's views are on the Director of Finance letter seeking an additional $1 billion next year. The Cabinet Secretary told the committee that this request was just impossible ever to meet as the public spending watchdog. And considering the committee will hear from three Directors of Finance after this panel, what is the Commission's view on the Directors of Finance request?
Well, this takes us, I think, into the territory of what level of funding is sufficient, what level of funding is appropriate. And that's really not something where we can help you very much. That's essentially, we would say, a political judgment rather than a technocratic judgment. And we're technocrats, by and large. Again, do you want to elaborate, Andrew?
No, I mean, just to amplify that, convener, I mean, it's not a territory we would really, as a commission, want to stray into about what the quantum should be. I mean, there's clearly a difference of opinion between the government and COSLA. That's obvious for everybody to see. But as a commission, as the convener, as the chair has said, I mean, we need to look at the technical side of the debate. And technically, the position is, as Bill's just outlined, there has been this real terms increase this year for the first time in 6 years, but the longer term picture is challenging, undoubtedly. And I guess all I can add in addition, everybody knows this. I mean, it's obvious from the overall flow of our reports that there is huge and significant and growing pressure on local government finances. Nobody surely could deny that. But there has to be a political decision about the overall quantum of funding to address those pressures and whether flexibility can be built into the funding packages that local government has available to it. And I'm sure we may come on to that as a specific topic throughout the course of this morning's discussion. Hope that helps.
Yeah, thank you for that. Yes, flexibility certainly is something that's being talked about a lot. I'm now going to bring in Willie Coffey with a number of questions.
Thanks very much, convener, and good morning, Bill and colleagues. I wonder if we could start off talking about our much-loved subject of ring fencing. I think maybe somebody will write a book about ring fencing one day, so perhaps we might all understand it. But some of the figures that are going around, Bill, tell us that you think that 23% of local government's revenue funding is direct or ring fenced. These are shared priorities, of course. The Scottish Government think that portion is about 7%, but COSLA think it's 60%. Could you offer some reflections on how each of the parties arrive at these figures, and particularly yourselves, how you arrived at the 23?
Well, let me kick off then. I'll bring Blythe in, who's the technical expert here. We do think that about 7%, 8% of local authority expenditure is ring-fenced by law. Local authorities have absolutely no discretion in how to spend the money. We get to the total of 23 by then adding in the money that is not technically legally ring-fenced, but it has serious conditions attached, so that in practice local authorities would argue that they have very little discretion over how they spend that money. The government, of course, will argue that they have discretion. But in practice, the pressures on local authorities to spend the money in the way the government says it wants spent are pretty intense. Blythe, do you want to talk a bit more?
Sure. Thanks, Bill. I think the Chair of the Accounts Commission is correct in his assessment. I think the message that the Accounts Commission are keen to get across from the reports is that there has been a steady increase in the proportion of total revenue funding that's received by councils that is ring-fenced either formally or coming with direction. So the expectation is that it is spent on particular service areas or projects or priorities. So in terms of our findings in the report, this is not something we've done in the past. However, this year, in terms of providing that additional clarity, we thought that we would offer our assessment of what we consider to be ring-fenced or directed. So in the past, we've obviously seen that huge discrepancy between what the Scottish Government would consider to be ring-fenced and what COSLA consider to be ring-fenced. Ours broadly fits in between, but the rationale behind it has been explained by the Chair. I think that a big aspect of it that we set out in Exhibit 3 of the report is the transfers from other portfolios. So we can see for the 23-24 budget that that totals £1.5 billion, so it's hugely significant. That has steadily increased over the past 3 years. So in 21-22, it was £500 million. 22-23 increased to £1.3 billion. And for 23-24, increasing to £1.5 billion. So that has been a huge part of that increase in the either ring-fenced or directed funding. Mm-hmm.
Thanks for that, Blythe. Your estimate, though, is nowhere near in the middle of the two, really. I mean, the COSLA estimate is 60%. I mean, have you any inclination, any idea how... I mean, we can ask an expert all that, but I was hoping to hear your views too about why they think it's such a high percentage, 60% ring-fenced.
It's probably quite difficult for me to answer that one, Mr. Coffey. Experts and directors of finance will be able to provide more. but just in terms of the interpretations of what's ring-fenced, so COSLA would consider... For example, the additional funding for pay deals or financial flexibilities included within the overall total that's ring-fenced, also things like loans fund repayments. So there's lots of different elements that I'm probably not the best expert to talk to you about that this morning. But yeah, the colleagues may be able to fill you in this session later.
Thanks very much for making a valiant attempt explaining the differences. Thanks very much for that. On budget gaps, Bill, we can see that the notes have here, the budget gaps by council range from 1% Argyll and Bute to 22% in Shetland. Have you any idea, could you offer some views on why such huge gaps exist between councils in terms of their funding gaps?
Well, again, I'd like to bring Blythe in because he really is the technical expert on this. Blythe.
Sure, yeah. So within the financial bulletin, we set out the aggregate budget gap for all councils for both 21-22 and 22-23. So for both years, this is around about £0.4 billion. So although there is that variance in terms of the individual budget gaps at a local level, the quantum is broadly similar. So there is that consistency. It's correct to highlight that there are big differences. So from the top, Shetland all the way down to Argyll and Bute. Shetland can probably be considered an outlier in this particular analysis. So as you can see, I think it's up to close to 20%. This is due to the decision-making locally in Shetland, whereby reserves are used to plug that funding gap. So I think for both years, 21-22 and 22-23, 99% of the gap is due to be closed by use of reserves. Now, clearly that presents an issue in terms of the sustainability of that approach, because reserves, by their very nature, are non-recurring, and once they've been used, they've been used. So there will need to be consideration at a local level in that particular example about a more sustainable approach to closing budget gaps in the future. I think what that does do, though, as well, it highlights that individual budget gaps are driven largely by local circumstances and local decision-making. So, for example, some councils may choose to use reserves if they have that luxury, if we can call it that, whereas others, maybe not in that same position, will not be able to do so. Also, previous performance in terms of delivering recurring savings will contribute to the budget gap that then kind of proceeds in the following years. There's other elements that can play into this as well around the decisions that councils take, for example, with council tax rate increases, not so much over the last couple of years, of course, but there's a degree of variance in terms of how much councils raise through that, also through fees and charges. As well as the use of the financial flexibilities that have been afforded by the Scottish Government. So that explains why there's a bit of a variance. Our analysis then builds on to how councils plan to bridge that gap. So I can offer some analysis on that, if that would be interesting.
Yeah, that's really helpful, Blythe. Again, and you mentioned the reserves there, which brings me on to my next query for you. There's quite a varied picture there. I think you said, Bill, in your opening remarks, that two-thirds of the councils are planning to use them, so therefore a third aren't.
clearly. Is there guidance around the use of reserves and the level of which they should reasonably be able to deploy? And do councils broadly follow that advice and guidance? Clearly, a third of them are deciding not to deploy them and are perhaps looking at cuts to bridge the gap.
We worry about the use of reserves by councils. I mean, reserves are meant to be there for serious unexpected events, or maybe to smooth financially the path from one pattern of services to another, but they're not meant to fund day-to-day running costs, core running costs. And we understand why councils are doing it, but we have been saying to them increasingly loudly that this is not a sustainable strategy, that reserves are finite, and when they're spent, they're spent. And if you don't rebuild them, you'll wake up one morning and find that you are in real trouble. So we're pressing councils very hard to be very thoughtful about not just spending reserves, but also projecting forward. If we spend this level of reserve this year, what do the next 2 or 3 years look like? And at what point are reserves on present patterns of expenditure quite likely to run out and leave us stuck? So for today, I wouldn't criticise local authorities for spending reserves because they are in a very, very tight position. But if that pattern continues, we will have more to say about it.
There will be guidance around it, I would imagine, though. I mean, if a council were to decide to deploy and spend all of its reserves in 1 year, I'm sure they legally might not be permitted to do so. Is there guidance around that that they by and large follow, I presume?
Well, they have to break even taking 1 year with the next. But, Blythe, do you want to add?
I would need to check that, Mr Coffey, just for to be sure. What I would say is, though, that the Accounts Commissioner of Scotland have issued guidance in the past with a recommended level, which we would see as being prudent in terms of maintaining a reserves balance of around about 2 to 4% of net revenue expenditure. So that gives you an idea of kind of what we would expect to see, almost as that sort of contingency reserve. Clearly, with the situation in the past few years with COVID funding, reserves have almost been artificially inflated. So if you look at the report, we present a figure of £4.1 billion of usable reserves, which makes it look like councils are awash with cash and they've got so much contingency to fall back on. But actually, within Exhibit 8 in the report, we show that actually only £0.4 billion of that is uncommitted. So that would be the true contingency. The rest of that is committed for particular purposes. Now, in terms of just following on from what the Chair mentioned, one of the messages that we were keen to get across in our reports, certainly last year, were around the transparency of reserves. So we've seen a big improvement in that this year in terms of councils having a greater degree of detail as to what is actually making up those reserve balances. But if we take that one step further, what I think would be really helpful would be to have the transparency around the plans for spending those reserves, including timescales. So it's not clear from the accounts how long some of those funds have been in reserves and whether or not those plans are still, you know, in line with the priorities of the council. So there's maybe a wee bit more for councils to do in terms of taking that forward to the next step. But as I say, definite improvements from what we saw last year to what we've seen this year.
OK, thanks again, Blythe. Lastly from me, Convener. Well, we mentioned the savings targets a few moments ago too, and my notes here say that 2021-22, most of the savings targets were achieved by councils. So has there been any assessment carried out by yourselves about the impact of those savings and jobs and services and so on, and what are we looking at going ahead? Because you, in your opening remarks, you painted quite a bleak picture of the task facing councils in terms of the funding gaps that they're having to face. So having successfully made all those savings from the past, how much more can they do to save in the future?
Well, we'll be publishing a second overview report in May, looking at council's performance as opposed to just finance. And I would expect us to cover that kind of point then. Do you want to say any more, Blythe or Andrew?
Yeah. I mean, maybe if I bring it back, Willie, to the point you raised right at the start of your contribution about ring fencing. I mean, I think, without going into whose figures are correct, I mean, I think one thing that we can all agree on around ring fencing, which is linked to the point about potential savings, is whatever the ring fencing percentage is, it has a gearing effect on where savings can be made. The more that's ring fenced, the less areas there are for local authorities to make potential savings. And so the vast bulk of the ring fencing, no matter which figure you go with, is around education, health and social care. And that pushes the savings into roads, footways, libraries, culture and leisure, and it becomes increasingly difficult for local authorities, therefore, as you've been alluding to in your last question there, to make savings going forward because of the disproportionate gearing effect of the ring fence. And no matter which percentage figure you accept, it's a real challenge for local authorities as to where to find the savings year on year on year.
Yep. OK, thanks very much. Oh, Carol?
I would just add to that we've got the local government benchmarking framework and the data that's in that, and we'll do an analysis of that in our local government overview. But what we sometimes find is that performance using that data plateaus. It doesn't necessarily drop off. But what we're hearing anecdotally from councils is that services are becoming more rationed. So the criteria in which to receive services are becoming tougher. So in terms of how services are performing and what are the outcomes for people, is there's more unmet need. Now, that's really difficult to quantify, but the more that you have to ration services and make criteria before people can access them more stringent, then there are people that are not receiving services. So there is the data only tells part of the picture.
OK. Thank you very much for that. Bill, did you want to finally come back?
One other thought, if I may. I'm not sure it's wise just to look at savings in isolation. I think increasingly councils have to think also about their charging policies, what they charge for, what they don't charge for, whether their charges levied meet the costs of the service delivered and so on. So I think it all has to be taken together. And that's why we press councils not just to think in terms of 1 year, but to have a medium-term financial plan that brings these things together and demonstrates their sustainability.
So we'll be coming to those issues just in a wee while, I hope, Bill. But thank you very much for answering the questions. Back to you.
Thanks, Willie. We've got a few supplements on the back of that. So I'm going to bring in Mark on local savings targets, and then Paul is going to come in and take us back to ring fencing, our favourite topic.
Okay. Thanks, Convener. It's on future savings targets, and we've seen local authorities some of them have produced plans on where they expect to make savings, and you know, pretty tough decisions they're coming to. One example is Glasgow, where they've proposed making savings on teacher numbers, but then we've had a government intervention essentially to see that would be blocked. My question is, how do local government go about making plans for achievable savings targets when, you know, there is a potential for government to step in and say, well, actually, no, we don't like that and we won't let you do that?
It puts councils in a very difficult position. And one of our messages today and every time we're asked is that the whole question of ring fencing really has to be sorted out. We have to get to the point where everyone's pretty clear what is absolutely required of local authorities and what are the areas of discretion. Just at the moment, I think it's very unclear for councils, and they've just got to do their best, but that's not a satisfactory position going forward. Do you want to add?
Yeah, I mean, just to add to what the Chair said, Mark, I mean, it is linked to the issue of the gearing effect that I mentioned in response to Willie's earlier questions, you know, because the straight answer to your question is it's incredibly difficult for local authorities to make the savings year on year. And what you've just raised, you know, very topical just in the news in the last week, is one of those illustrations that Bill was alluding to, where it's not formally ring-fenced, but now councils have been told they can't go there, potentially. I know this is open to potential legal challenge, but it just illustrates the point that the more and more that happens, then the less areas that local authorities have to make fiscal savings year on year. I'm sure it will come round in the discussion. It all feeds into the question about the levels of flexibility, fiscal flexibility and freedoms that local authorities have or don't have going forward. And, you know, that was supposed to be all that was going to come out through the New Deal and the earlier iterations of the local governance review, which we're obviously all waiting with bated breath for. But until we see all that, then local authorities are in an increasingly difficult position.
Thank you.
Thanks. Paul?
Yeah, thanks, Convener. And it's really just building on that question about ring fencing, because one of the key things, we had a differential between what COSLA are saying and what government are saying, between 7 and 60%. There are shared objectives that are in there, but it's maybe coming back to the procedural point, and that comes back to the point that you made, Bill and Andrew, in terms of where is that kind of agreed, because we're going into a budget process, and this is happening during the budget process, which makes it extremely difficult for any councils to plan. Do you have any views in terms of the procedure before that, in terms of how do we agree shared objectives, how do we agree, you know, in terms of the ring fence and where that sits? Because for me, I don't want to be in this position next year in terms of that. So do we have to, is there a lesson that you think we need to learn for next year in terms of ring fence, particularly in terms of shared objectives and where we go? Because we can't be facing this every single year in terms of Causes saying one thing, Scottish Government saying the other, and it seems procedural. And I know that it's not as simple as that, but is there something we can learn for next year's budget process to go, let's try and simplify this in terms of that, because it's far too complicated at this stage. We're a few weeks away from when councils will be setting their budgets, and we still don't know what's kind of, you know, what's our shared objectives and where do we go with that. It's too messy. I don't know what your views are on that.
Well, if I can kick off, and then I'll bring in the experts. One of the things that seems to me that is not happening and should happen is that councils have to move quickly to reassure the populations they serve that if they're changing how services are designed or delivered, that doesn't mean to say services are going to be worse. In some cases, it might be. We have to acknowledge that. But my worry about the debate as it's going on at the moment is that it would be very easy for this approach to squeeze out innovation and just to say the way we've always done it is the way we're going to do it in the future. And I think the onus is really on local authorities to get their populations on side, to show a longer-term plan than just this year, this is what we're going to do and we'll work out next year later. I think they really do have to start engaging their population, making sure that people understand the arguments, understand the risks, understand how the risks are going to be managed, and try and get their populations comfortable. If the population is not agitating, then ministers centrally are more likely to say, well, let's step back and let the local authority give it a go and see if it works. I think the danger at the moment is that changes in the way services are designed and delivered are introduced at a very late stage, apparently for financial reasons and nothing else. And I can understand why parents of children in the case of education get jumpy. And then when the population starts to get agitated, central government ministers want to try and calm things down, and they therefore want to leave things alone, don't change anything. But you can't run a local authority on that basis. But I think the initiative has to come from local government. Andrew, do you want to add?
Yeah, I mean, I think I completely agree with the point you've just alluded to, Paul, about you don't want to be in this situation next year. I think I can say, you know, quite firmly on behalf of the Commission don't want to see local government in this position next year either, and I'm sure local government don't want to be in this position. I'm also quite certain the Scottish Government don't want to be in this position. And it takes me back to what I said in response to Mark's supplementary. I mean, the long-awaited New Deal, which would include a fiscal framework, would hopefully address many of the points you've just outlined. You know, a set of rules jointly agreed by the Scottish Government and COSLA around what was and wasn't ring-fenced or loosely ring-fenced or formally ring-fenced, whatever terminology you want to use. And I know the Cabinet Secretary was here just a couple of weeks ago and made the point that the New Deal is unlikely, including the fiscal framework, is unlikely to be ready for the new financial year. And I understand, the Commission understands the reasons for that, you know, the pressures that the whole UK economy, if not the whole world economy, has been under, has led to understandable delay. But this all goes back to the Local Governance Review, which was launched in December 2017. It's over 5 years ago. And to get a position you want to see, I think, Paul, that we want to see, where this doesn't happen, we need to see the New Deal delivered on. And I hope the committee will really press hard on that. I mean, we accept that there's challenges that the government and local authorities are facing in delivering the final version of it, but it is very, very long overdue, and it would hopefully help address many of the specific points about the rules and agreements between COSLA and the Scottish Government that you've raised.
Thank you. That's very helpful.
Thanks very much. I think we're beginning to stray into a question that I'm really keen to ask. So, Bill, I think when you were at a previous panel with us, but also in the introduction to the financial bulletin, you've stated that if councils are to find a safe path through the difficult times ahead, they need to focus more on service reform. And got a couple of questions here. What more can the Scottish Government, the Parliament and COSLA do to assist with that process of reform? And also, I'd be interested to hear if you've got some specifics in mind. I've not been a councillor, so I've got colleagues here who have been. But, you know, what are you getting at there that needs to be reformed?
Well, if I can take the first part, and then I'll bring Andrew in on the second part, because he has been a councillor, and like you, I have not. But, I mean, I think one of the points that we are trying to stress is that simply doing things the way they've always been done is not a sustainable strategy. And councils have got to be prepared to think about different ways to innovate, different ways to deliver services. And most of all, I think, they've got to engage their populations. If they don't engage people and talk to people and are honest with people and debate things and are seen to change their mind occasionally when the population seems to have the better arguments, then they will not be trusted by the population, and the pressures will be leave everything alone. But given the financial pressures, and also given what we learned during the COVID pandemic about how services could be changed and how they could be delivered, and whether all the central government controls that apply need to be applied all the time, I think there's a lot of merit in discussing how do we do things differently. But it has to be an open discussion, I think.
Yeah, maybe just, thanks, Bill. Maybe just to try and give one illustration, convener. I mean, from my experience in a previous life, I mean, it is very difficult, you know, but one way of potentially transforming service delivery is to do it in cooperation with your partner, normally your geographically, locally placed authorities. So I was involved in City of Edinburgh Council. We had lots of joint working with Mid, East, West, Lothian, and Fife and the Borders even. And you know, you see that in some structures as well. The transport partnerships, health and social care partnerships are often across regions and not just individual local authority areas. But it's not straightforward. And I'm afraid it does take us back to the whole debate we've just been having about ring fencing and the gearing effect that I mentioned in response to Willie's earlier comment. Because the more that is ring fenced, no matter which figure you accept, the harder it becomes for local authorities to innovate. So that the more flexibility they've got, the easier it would be for the chair to see what he wants to see in terms of service innovation by local authorities. So, and I guess that brings us back round to the New Deal. If we had an agreed set of rules between COSLA and the Scottish Government about what was and wasn't to be delivered and what was directed and what wasn't directed, then that would hopefully free up a bit of space around what could be done. For example, along the lines of the one I've just mentioned, cooperation with partners, you know, mainly geographically adjacent local authorities. So there certainly are things that can be done. There's no doubt about that. But a new framework would help greatly in just freeing up that space for that to be undertaken with a bit more vigour.
Thanks for that. Carol?
I think coming back to the New Deal again, the partnership agreement will be very important in that. And what you were saying earlier about shared objectives, councils would argue that they're not shared objectives necessarily, that they are not at the table in determining what some of the policy objectives are, and they would like to be involved in that discussion and recognising that they are all the councils are diverse, one size does not fit all, and that local needs are, and the knowledge of local areas is held by the people in the councils. They've got the engagement with communities, as Bill said, that's vitally important. But I think if there was more flexibility for local government to work with Scottish Government around shared objectives and how what is the role of local government going forward? Are they service providers? Are they implementers of national policy? Or are they stewards of place? Are they there to enable, facilitate what happens locally? So I think there's some tensions in the system as it currently exists around what do local authorities do, and the partnership agreement I think could be really important in setting that out, and the recognition of the relationship between local government and Scottish Government change, where local government are given the flexibility to implement national policy in a way that suits local needs, as opposed to it being one size fits all.
Thank you for that. One of the things that comes to mind, so the committee is just started as of yesterday a series of inquiries into the community planning partnership. So you've mentioned partnerships, but didn't mention that one. And it's kind of interesting because in conversation with communities, they feel that they're not at the table with councils. And it would seem to me that potentially that is another opportunity. There's kind of working geographically with fellow councils, but it seems to be maybe there's this piece, and we've got this in this local governance review, and it seems to be the third part of the New Deal is that relationship with third sector and with community that seems to need to be picked up. And certainly we've got this opportunity with the review of the Communities Empowerment Act to bring that in potentially.
Yeah. Convener, I would strongly agree with the point you're getting at here, that yes, there are things within local authorities and the community partnerships are absolutely one mechanism where, you know, with the involvement, as the chair of the commission has already said, with the involvement of local communities, they can get input from the experts, because it's service recipients who are often the experts. You know, all of us are service recipients of many, many local authority services, and sometimes that input from service recipients is lacking and can be very, very beneficial. And through the Accounts Commission's best value reports of all 32 local authorities, we do look at how local authorities are developing and using community partnership and community planning. And the picture is varied, frankly, across Scotland. Some are absolutely excellent and do involve the local communities in great detail, others much less so. And so I'd encourage the committee, if you've got the time and inclination, to have a look at some elements of the best value reports that the Commission has produced that highlight some of the best practice around community planning and community partnerships.
That's great. Yes, we did get a varied picture yesterday. Carol?
I was just going to say, if we look at how councils and communities and partners work through COVID, there are lessons to be learned there. The art of the possible was demonstrated during that period of time. And I suppose what was different was there was a very clear common purpose that councils and communities and Scottish Government were working to. There was a scaling down of bureaucracy to make things happen at pace. Yeah. There was trust in the community to deliver services and trust in councils to know what was needed in local areas. And I think that is the exemplar of how it can work. And I think disrespecting the boundaries between different agencies and working in terms of serving the place and the needs of the place is very, very important. And I think that's where we can make change. I'd also direct you, as well as the best value audit reports, to the Community Empowerment Principles document that we produced in 2019. And we did a COVID follow-up in 2021. And there were five guiding principles, which was community control, public sector leadership, effective relationships, improving outcomes and accountability. Now, those principles could be applied to your previous question about reform as well, and how do we make services change. So I think we can look to COVID and how councils worked with communities and partners then and say, look at what can be done and why did that work. And some of the things around that are about loosening of the ties, trust, and scaling down around bureaucracy.
Thank you. Thanks very much for that, Carol. We will definitely take a look at those principles that you've just outlined further. But I also liked what you asked. You kind of posed a question previously about, you know, are councils stewards of place? And that's certainly something that's coming up now with the National Planning Framework. And we're really talking about making place in 20-minute neighbourhoods. So that's an interesting element there. And it feels like there's some things that we need to join together more. I'm not going to bring in Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. Thanks for joining us today. I wanted to ask a question with regards to local authority net debt. And we know that's increased by 0.2 billion to 16.4 billion in the last financial year. Why do you think that's happened? And is there a variation in different councils around that additional debt level? And I wanted to also ask specifically with regards to public-private partnership agreements and any variation which is maybe impacting on debt levels in different councils which you're aware of as well. So a few questions in there.
Well, I'll ask Brian to kick off and then we might come in. Bye.
Sure, thanks. Absolutely. So the overall increase in net debt was £0.2 billion in 21-22. Actually contrasts quite sharply with the previous year. So there was actually a £1 billion decrease. This was as a result of the late COVID funding that was received. So had a huge knock-on effect to the cash balances of councils. So in comparison, it does feel like quite a small movement, but, you know, absolutely happy to talk through our understanding of why that has happened. So just under half of councils increased their net debt in 21-22. And without trying to oversimplify things, what we mean by net debt is the overall total of debt that councils hold minus their cash and investments. So ultimately, the overall increase in net debt could be related to an increase in total debt, but it could also be related to a decrease in cash and investment balances. So the analysis that we did carry out would suggest that is the kind of main reason as to why that has happened. So 19 of 32 councils increased their long-term borrowing 15 of 32 increased short-term borrowing, and 20 of 32 had lower cash and investment balances. So that feels like the kind of main reason as to why that movement has been recorded within the accounts. What I was going to say in terms of the overall understanding of net debt at a local level, largely be driven by the sort of local treasury management or capital investment strategies that are in place. Now, that's not something that we've reviewed as part of our overview, just given the nature of the overview, but we do get information from local audit teams who carry out work, and this will be firmly on their radar. There haven't been any weaknesses identified that have been brought to our attention, so that's about as much as I can offer by way of a conclusion on how effective they are. We did have a look at some year-on-year movements in terms of understanding any reasons why certain councils had a bigger increase in net debt than others, but it was nothing particularly exciting. Some increases in finance lease obligations, councils taking additional borrowing to assist with cash flow purposes, taking advantage of quite attractive interest rates at a point in time. So, as I say, nothing that really jumps out as a particular red flag. And as I say, the overall position seems fairly normal.
That's a very helpful and detailed answer. Do you think there's any correlation between councils with higher net debt levels then and their central government funding level? Has that been explored? My own council here in Edinburgh, Aberdeen, are the two lowest funded, for example.
The quick answer is it's not been explored, so I'm not really able to offer an answer to that one at the moment, but it's certainly something we can consider as part of future financial bulletin work going forward. As I say, it's not been on the radar up until now.
No, that's helpful. Thank you. And in terms of public-private partnerships, is there any more detail over where they're going in the future and potential changes, which I know some councils are looking, payback terms, things like that? And has any of that been flagged to you during your investigations as well?
Not at the moment. We do have information that we draw from the accounts in terms of the split between the short and long-term liabilities related to those PPP contracts. And as the Cabinet Secretary mentioned to the committee a few weeks back, the aspect of value for money in some of those contracts is perhaps not what it might have been. So it's not something we've analysed at this point. There's nothing that we've kind of been made aware of in terms of those changes to the approach. Council Directors of Finance might be able to offer more insight into that at a local level, but as I say, it's nothing that the Accounts Commission or that Scotland have picked up at this point.
That's helpful. Thank you. We've talked about the COVID additional resources a few times from some of the questions, and I just wondered if you had anything you could contribute with regards to lessons that have really been learnt about maybe different service delivery models going forward, and whether or not that's embedded. I certainly know the third sector were really utilised during the COVID period, and whether or not there has been any longer term shift towards delivery of services and potential savings around that as well.
Yeah, thanks, Ms. Smith. Just on that point about lessons from the COVID-19, you know, obviously none of us would have wished it had happened, but just building on the points that Carol made, I mean, lots of things were done very, very effectively, and you made the specific point about the involvement of the voluntary sector in the service delivery at a local level. You know, I'm not going to sit here and claim it was all 100% perfect, but there was a lot of really innovative and very, very fast-paced and effective service delivery undertaken during the immediate aftermath of the sort of March 20 to December 2020 period. Some of that is still going on, but I think the Commission would say that there's a lot of evidence that we're going back to old ways. And it sounds like I'm a stuck record, but it takes us back to the New Deal and the fiscal framework that might come within that. I mean, if there was, as Carol was indicating, if there was a loosening of rules, if there was more trust, if there was more flexibility, potentially more revenue reason, avenues for local authorities to follow, and they could then pass on those conditions to the voluntary sector in their own local area, all of that would sort of potentially replicate the atmosphere of service delivery and service transformation that we saw during the height of COVID-19. And I think the Commission is worried that whilst there was a lot of good practice, as Carol was saying, during that period, and some of it has continued, a lot of it is now starting to look like we're going back to the old sort of rules and regulations.
Yeah,
I'm afraid.
Yeah, we've heard that previously as well. Yeah,
So we're just pulling together the local government overview, the more narrative report, which will be out in May. And that's something we're exploring in that report. What we haven't been able to see is a big shift towards different models of service delivery. So there isn't a big shift that we can see as yet around joint services or lead councils. Some services, maybe it's once for Scotland. I think that's been discussed as options as well. We're not seeing that change yet, but there is a lot of discussion and appetite about how the model for councils needs to change. And I think it does come back to that point about what are councils for. But at the moment, we're not seeing that shift. And I suppose the danger is that the learning points and the flexibilities that were available during the COVID pandemic, if they tighten up, then it restricts councils' ability to do things differently. And I think there is a lot to be said about freedoms. When there's more flexibility and there's more freedoms, there's more ability to innovate. And that involves discussions with communities as well. So it all kind of is wrapped up: community empowerment, place, local needs, local knowledge, local potential. All of that kind of comes to play. But at the minute, we're not seeing that change. What we are going to be saying in that report, though, is that it can't go on. Councils are financially not sustainable and services are not sustainable going forward unless there is a big shift to the way that services are provided.
Yeah. Just one final question. You know, we've had integration of health and social care, we've had a pandemic, and we now have what the government's proposing with the National Care Service. I know from speaking to councillors from all parties, actually, that then creates a kind of environment where actually you're not being able to look towards what has been, what currently is, and what you want in the future. So do you think that's preventing some of that innovation and capturing different models which have been successful during the pandemic, to embed them now rather than sort of grey. I'm trying to think of the right word to say. It's sort of a pause we're seeing while we wait to see what Parliament's going to present to councils, really.
I'm sure that is an issue. I mean, I think if you ask some of the people in the next session, I'm sure they'll be able to confirm that. But the uncertainty about what's happening with the National Care Service, so the uncertainty about what the workforce might look like, uncertainty about what local government will look like when social care is removed from it, all of those things, I think, inhibit the creative space required to actually be looking at different ways of delivering things. So I'm sure it gets in the way. I think that's probably a question that you need to ask about, you know, council directors and chief executives as well.
Thank you. Thanks very much.
Thanks, Miles. I'm now going to bring in Paul McClellan.
Thank you, Convener. I want to move on to revenue raising options open to councils, one on a short-term basis and one on a more medium to longer-term basis. So I'll start with the short-term basis, and it's really just what you're thinking about, your views are at the moment, and about what's councils' ability, I suppose, to look to raise their own income, and how much has that changed over the last decade. The second part of the question, looking at longer term, is we've been doing a wee bit of work in terms of what other countries do in terms of local government finance. Scotland is approximately, and the rest of the UK is approximately, raises 15% of its own income. If you look at Europe, that's about 50%-ish. So, and we've kind of looked at workforce parking levy, we've looked at the visitor tax levy and so on, which is kind of almost a start. But the question for me is, do we have to look at how we can give local authorities more powers in terms to do that? Now they can pick or choose from these powers that are there now. And I'm not suggesting Scotland goes down this route, but some other countries, for example, have a local sales tax, have local income tax, other taxes that they've got. So it's really just looking at from both the short term and the medium to longer term, what your thoughts are on that ability to raise their own income.
Well, we're certainly encouraging local authorities to think across the whole range of services of whether there's a case for charging. If there is, what level of charging would match the cost of delivering those services? But there's a long way to go. I mean, the public, in our estimation, assumes that public services are free at the point of need, based on the NHS model, although it's not true of the NHS and it's not true of most services. So there's a lot of work to do, I think, to change the acceptance of charging before you actually get into the detail of charging. Our view would certainly be that local authorities need to get on with it. But it can't just be a kind of blind blanket charge for everything. It's got to be really thought through. And again, the community has got to be engaged and they've got to understand the reasons for it. But let me bring colleagues in. Carol, do you want to come in?
Yeah, I was just going to say that I know that some parts of the sector are calling for more powers around general competence rather than specific income raising powers. Because Scotland is diverse and every council will tell you that they're different from the next, and what will suit those local communities in terms of how they can raise money. So parking and visitor levies may not be great for certain communities, but there are different kind of levies that they might see that would be appropriate for them. But do they have the general competence in order to pursue that? So I suppose it's about, again, flexibility and freedoms. I definitely can't answer off the top of my head what the change has been over the last decade in terms of income and fees. It's never been an enormous part of the budget, but I think the one thing that we would be concerned about, that any revenue raising powers and any revenue raised is not a substitute for core funding. Revenues raised in the local community ought to be flexible for that council to spend in the local community. So I think that is the point I'd like to make.
Yeah, I mean, we very much agree with the latter point that Carol made there about any flexibilities that are delivered, and I'll come on to hopefully try and address the short and longer-term points you raised, Paul, in a minute, need to be seen as additional to core revenue. You know, that core revenue has to cover the delivery of core services. And I think, to come to your point about short and medium to longer term, I mean, there's not been a lot of movement. I don't think the Commission can see in the last few years around flexibilities. But there is a little glimmer of hope, if that's the right phrase, in terms of what's coming down the tracks. And everybody will be aware, you know, we're sitting in Edinburgh with a transient or a visitor levy is now being approved and will come into operation in the next year or so. None of us, Commission, MSPs, local councils, won't know the full effect of that for a few more years now. But to the Commission's view, is a welcome willingness to devolve some powers to local authorities, to give them that degree of flexibility to add on to the core revenue or the core grant that Carol just alluded to. But there's a lot more that could be done.
Just on that point, and it comes back to the point that Carol made as well about the general competence, and that's maybe something that needs to be raised, and I don't know if that's something maybe through the New Deal again in terms of looking at that, because if it is that general competence, it is widening the ability for local authorities to look at that. But I don't think that can be done. I think it needs to be done right across, you know, if that's a discussion with COSLA in terms of that. But I think that's a really valid point, I think.
No, I would agree. And I mean, maybe just to make a final point about the 50% figure you mentioned, Paul. Yeah. I mean, I'm very familiar with this. It is a figure that applies to most of continental Europe. And also, I have to say, much of England can raise up to 50%. Local authorities can raise up to 50% of their revenue directly, whereas it's much, much lower, as you said, here in Scotland. There's been loads of work done on this. I mean, I've forgotten the exact name of the report, but COSLA produced a really detailed study on this. I think it was called Strength in Local Democracy in 2008-09, which showed a path to get from where we are now, I think 13, 18, you know, it varies a little bit, to sort of 40%. It brings us back round to a potential inclusion of some of that in a New Deal and a fiscal framework, because that would give local authorities a huge boost in terms of flexibility to add on to the funding of core services that would allow them to hopefully pick up on some of the transformation points that the Chair has been making in earlier comments to the convener. Okay.
Thanks,
convener.
I've
got a second question, this is a different one. Obviously, we kind of talked about there. Obviously, there's inflationary pressures at the moment, and obviously there's also obviously long-standing capital spending that the local authorities planned for. Now, inflation from last year to this year has jumped up massively. Nobody could have predicted it going there. I suppose the question is, are you confident local authorities can invest in infrastructure that they've almost agreed on in the last year or two in terms of where inflationary pressures are now at?
I think the thing that really will have an impact, and it's just beginning to emerge, is the impact of increased interest rates. We've had a lengthy period of very, very low interest rates, and we've kind of got used to that as being the norm, and it's not the norm. And when I was preparing for this, one case that was drawn to my attention was Highland Council planning to to build a school using borrowing. And initially, the project was the construction cost was 15 million. Initially, the amount to be paid back was about 23 million. But that was when interest rates were 2%. With interest rates in the 5 to 6% region, the amount the council will have to pay back is now 50 million. And now that's bound to influence the assessment of whether this is a viable project or not. And I think we're seeing quite a lot of similar things happening, that, that people are scratching their heads and saying, well, I wonder if we should do this project or if we should do it as quickly as we were planning or whatever. So that, that's part, I think, that we just have to keep an eye on. Do you want to add?
No.
Carl, do you want to?
Bill, just on that, because again, that's the next question I was going to ask, was, you know, will you be monitoring that over the next year? Because I think that there will be that impact on capital projects being delivered or delayed or spread over a longer period of time. So,
undoubtedly. I mean, our annual financial bulletin will look at it from a financial point of view, and our overview bulletin will look at it from the point of view of impact on services. So, yes,
we'll be doing that. Thanks, Chair.
Thanks very much. We're now going to move to questions from Annie Wells, who's joining us online. Annie.
Good morning, convener, and good morning, panel. We've heard mention of the new deal sort of during this session. But what I would like to know is, what's the Commission's understanding of how the new deal between local government and Scottish Government is progressing? And what, in your view, are the obstacles to reaching an agreement?
Thanks, Annie. I mean, I'm possibly going to repeat a little bit of what I've said in the earlier comments, but I mean, our understanding as a Commission was that until very, very recently, it was on track to be formalised and concluded for the beginning of the financial year 23-24, so basically this April. And the Cabinet Secretary, I believe, was before you just a couple of weeks ago and confirmed that that's unfortunately not going to be the case. And I think from a Commission's perspective, we're sympathetic to the rationale and the reasons as to why, because there's been specific global and UK pressures around financial issues that have led to that delay. But I guess from our perspective at the Commission, all we would make a plea for is that, you know, it's that old saying, isn't it? You should really fix the roof while the sun's shining. And the sun ain't shining just now in a fiscal sense. It's a really, really challenging time, as the chair of the Commission has outlined already, for local authorities. And we really do need to see a longer term fiscal framework, you know, where potentially we could move away from single-year settlements for local authorities from the Scottish Government to maybe multi-year settlements. That would make a huge change to their ability to medium and long-term plan, all of part of a fiscal framework within a new deal. So our understanding is probably very similar to yours at the moment. It's based on what the Cabinet Secretary said a few weeks ago. I think I'm right in saying it, and it'll be on the record, she indicated that it would be potentially a few months away, I would just encourage everybody involved in this debate to keep the, in the most diplomatic way possible, keep the pressure on the government and COSLA to make sure that this is delivered within a few months, because there is a danger that we just end up slipping into the next electoral cycle. I mean, I mentioned right at the start, I think in answer to the convener's, one of the convener's original questions, that the local governance review, which precedes all of this, was first launched in December 2017, which was, you know, two cycles ago almost. And I think we just collectively need to guard against this slipping into another electoral cycle and make sure that that there is some jointly agreed fiscal framework within a new deal within the next few months, as the Cabinet Secretary said.
Perfect. Thank you for that, Andrew. And I think we all know the saying, when the sun's shining, fix that roof. But the other thing, you spoke about the sort of a fiscal framework and how that could operate in practice. You mentioned about multi-year funding and stuff like that. I mean, is there any other sort of a information you could shed light on as to how any other new financial arrangements could work?
Well, I might bring Blythe and Carolyn on the detail of this, but I mean, I would just refer the committee back to the resource spending review, which was launched in May 2022 by the Cabinet Secretary for Finance at the time, Kate Forbes, and that did outline in quite some detail what could be included in a fiscal framework. And I think I'm right in saying that's now been repeated in some written evidence that the current local government cabinet secretary Sean Robson has given to this committee, and she gave evidence orally just a few weeks ago, I've mentioned a few times, and there's a lot in the resource spending review, none of which I think, to the best of my knowledge, I'll turn to Blythe and Carol in a second, has been rowed back on, which could be part of, it's not just the longer term settlements, 1, 2, 3 years, but there's other aspects that are in that resource spending review which would make a great deal of difference to local authorities. But I don't know if Blythe wants to come in on it or Carol in the detail.
Yeah, just one minor point. So upon agreement of the fiscal framework, there's then the option to consider what that includes. Now, I know that the previous evidence session touched on this as well, around the distribution model. So that's something that could be reviewed at that point in time. Now, clearly, it's potentially presenting a situation where there may be winners and losers from a change in the distribution model. But, you know, it's for the Scottish Government and COSLA to determine what the right distribution model is. So is that based on, you know, primarily driven by population, or is there maybe a shift to look more towards deprivation as being the kind of main driving factor between how funding is distributed? So I think having the fiscal framework in place will make those discussions far more straightforward than they probably have been up until this point. But I think the sequencing of that is correct in terms of having the fiscal framework fully agreed before then engaging in those further discussions. So that's another aspect that I think, you know, there could be some really big benefits from exploring further.
I think there's some principles that we would like to see in the fiscal framework. We'd want to see that there's more certainty and stability, that services and funding, hence services, can be sustainable. Obviously, given the discussion we've had already, a reduction in ring fencing, we'd like to see more transparency and also more certainty in respect of kind of in-year changes, the money that comes in during the year. It's a very complicated picture throughout the year, many changes and additions to the budget, small amounts, large amounts, with conditions attached, without, with reporting requirements. I think a reduction of the burden on councils in terms of reporting on specific grants that they're given. Trying to think of what else we would want to see. Yeah, I think that, yeah, just those things really help councils improve their ability to plan and budget and look at services going ahead and create a bit of headspace to do the things that take a bit more time, like looking at prevention. So I think the New Deal in itself, how will it improve outcomes? How will it enable there to be better trust between local government, Scottish Government and communities? How will it enable them to work together to look at prevention? How will it early intervention, but also plans that are realistic and deliverable. So I think there are quite a lot of principles that we would like to see when we do see what it looks like.
Thank you very much for that. My final question, convener, is we heard about the local governance review, but basically what has happened to the wider local governance review beyond just the relationship with local authorities? And what should be happening to improve community empowerment, local democracy and community wealth building? Do you believe that the communities are more empowered than in 2015 when the Community Empowerment Act was passed? Maybe a question for Bill.
I think the short answer is, and I'm not sure that we know in detail, we are making it quite clear to local authorities that we believe very strongly in community empowerment and community engagement. Mm-hmm. It can be, I know from personal experience, quite a painful thing to do because people are not always very restrained in the criticisms that they offer. But it undoubtedly improves relationships and services. So as a philosophy, we think it's the right thing to do, and we want local authorities to be doing more of it across the piece. As for examples and what we think of them, Carol, do you have anything you can offer?
I wasn't thinking of examples, but I was thinking about everything that I just said kind of applies to that. It's very difficult for community empowerment to work if there isn't flexibility in what councils can do. So I think that's the fundamental for me. It's got to be real. It's got to be based on trust and cooperation, co-production, all of the things that we did see happen during the pandemic. But I think fundamental is that local flexibility to actually do things differently, because if you engage communities, you set up expectations that things might change, that things will change in the way they want them to. So the more flexibility locally to implement national policy in a local way to reflect local diversity, I think that's kind of the important part, really.
I guess, Annie, just to try and go back to your opening point there about what's happened to the local governance review. I mean, I think we maybe touched on this earlier, but just to reiterate, I mean, our understanding at the Commission and Audit Scotland is that the main tenets of the local governance review are basically, you can see this in the foreword and in the commentary to the resource spending review, are being subsumed into the resource spending review, which should deliver the fiscal framework as part of a new deal. So they are all interconnected, but there is a strong point I think you're alluding to, which is that we need to keep track of some of the commitments that were made way back in the local government, the initiation of the local governance review, which, as I've said several times, goes back to December 17, to make sure that those are being followed through in the delivery of a new deal fiscal framework as part of the RSR.
Thanks very much for that, panel. Thank you, convener.
Thanks, Annie. And thank you. That brings us to the end of our questions, and I think it's been a very useful conversation to get your perspectives in a bit more detail. So thank you so much for coming this morning, and I now suspend the meeting to allow for a change of witnesses. Our second panel today will focus on local government finance and potential fiscal arrangements under the New Deal for Local Government. And we're now joined in person by Martin Booth, who's the Executive Director of Finance at Glasgow City Council and the Chair of SIPFA Scotland Branch, and Kirsty Flanagan, who's the Executive Director at Argyll and Bute Council and is the Chair of the Local Government Directors of Finance Section. We're also joined online by Robert Emmett, who is the Executive Director of Corporate Services at Dundee City Council. And I welcome our witnesses to the meeting, and I'll open the session with the first few questions. The COSLA President told the committee that councils are facing probably the most worrying set of challenges that we have seen in local government for many years. I'd be interested to hear if you agree, and if so, what are the specific challenges facing your local authority and the communities they serve? And maybe I'll start with folks in the room, so maybe start with Kirsty.
Yeah, I would absolutely agree that we're facing significant challenges. I think many of the directors of finance within the section, this is probably the worst year they've ever experienced in terms of trying to balance the budget. And I think there's a perfect storm in that we've come out of COVID. We're faced with increasing inflation pressures, increasing interest rates, and also increased demand for services as well. So all these together give us a really challenging situation for balancing budgets within the current year we're in, within the next year we're about to enter in, and the financial sustainability of services into the future.
Thank you very much for laying out that difficult picture. Martin, do you have anything to add?
Kirsty's covered the main points. That kind of the pressure from inflation this year particularly has made this, I think that's what's made this the worst or most difficult year we've ever had. And the demand for services on the back of that because of the cost of living crisis really has been. But overall, the future financial sustainability of local government, I think, has to be brought into question, which did lead to the unprecedented act of the 32 local government directors of finance writing jointly to the Cabinet Secretary at the end of last year.
And Robert, also, if you want to come in, you can type an R in the chat function, but also I'll just bring you in now if you want to add anything to what we've just been talking about.
Thank you, Convener. I wanted to highlight the pressure from pay, and two-thirds certainly of our staff are pay, so a lot of our costs are pay-related, and I don't know if you've seen, but the SJC have recently put out their request for next year's pay settlement, which is around asking for a 12% uplift. So that pressure, I don't want to comment on the specifics of that, but just to highlight, really, that pressure hasn't gone away, and there's still a dispute going on around teachers' pay for the current year. And I think in previous years, we've had the ability to manage and to make changes to services in a context of a fairly low inflationary environment that we've been working in, and we're now in a very different place in the last period of time. And the other thing I'm thoughtful about in that context is the cost pressure on PFI and PPP contracts, on which are largely based on these statistical inflation indices, and so they're not escapable.
Thank you very much for that. I'm going to move on to conversation around the real terms increase. So the Accounts Commission highlighted a real terms increase in Scottish Government funding to local government in the 10 years since 2013 to 14, and again in 2023 to 24. There's a real terms increase compared to equivalent budget figures for 2022 to 23. Be interested to hear why local government argues that a settlement of $13.2 billion for local government is not enough and what more is required. And maybe, Martin, I'll start with you this time.
Yeah, thanks. And it was interesting, on the back of the Accounts Commission report that you've just been discussing and the press coverage on the back of that, a Scottish Government spokesperson was quoted where they quoted the real terms increase to Scottish Government's budget, but then quoted from local government in a cash terms. They didn't compare like with like, because like for like, they don't compare. There has been significant cash increases, but that's because they've come with additional services. So just in recent years, the introduction of 1140 hours, the introduction of free school meals, those services that have been introduced that are funded increase that amount of funding. And certainly earlier you asked about the £570 million. The £570 million is not an extra money to deliver existing services. It's predominantly to deliver
additional commitments from the Scottish Government, whether that be funding towards pay, whether it be the transfer of empty property relief from non-domestic rates to local government from Scottish Government. So it's additional services, the additional rollout, the next stage of Free School Meals is included with that as well. So actually the actual increase in Scottish Government, local government funding from Scottish Government this year is £71 million. The 38 you quoted earlier was before last week when another £32.8 million was returned to the local government settlement.
Okay. Any, Kirsty, anything to add?
I don't think I've got anything particular to add. I think it's unfortunate that that people compare it in different ways, and we would like to get to a position that, you know, we're all comparing the increases in the same way. I think also the context in which the £570 million spoken about was in the context of the ask from us and COSLA being £1 billion, but the £570 million and the £1 billion are two different things, because the £570 million is additional services, so it doesn't actually meet any of the £1 billion pressures. Or as Martin says, there's £71 million there that meets that £1 billion of pressures. So it's unfortunate that different figures get bandied about in different ways.
Thanks for that. And hopefully with the work being done on the New Deal, we can get that clarity and that alignment. Robert, I'm going to come to you with my next question first. So this is about the letter that that the Directors of Finance wrote to the Deputy First Minister. And it states that over the last 5 years, local government has delivered a range of new policy initiatives which have not always been fully funded over the longer term. I'd be interested to hear from your perspective, and then also others, if you've got other things to add. For example, which policy initiatives in particular have been delivered by councils, and what impact have these had on local authority finances?
Thanks, Kamina. So I think, I suppose I'd start by saying I don't see any significant, what councils are trying to do and what the governments are trying to do, I would say we're very lined up. And if I think about the priorities we've just agreed for our council about addressing child poverty, about addressing climate change, and about growing the economy, are very much in line with what the government's trying to do. So that piece you were just talking about, and about can we understand what the difference is and what we are trying to do. So the initiatives that councils have been taking forward, and I think the 1140 hours is perhaps one of the best examples where additional funding, significant additional funding, was provided to do something I think councils would support seeking, trying to do going forward, is absolutely very welcome. And that's what I mean. I don't think in policy terms there's a direction, but there is a real challenge in terms of how we're managing to deliver ongoing services that continue to need to be provided. Now, within my council, we've made savings of the order of 140 million over the last 10 years or so in terms of making things more efficient, redirecting resources to where they are needed. So funding has come for new initiatives, but we've had to look at what we are doing in the background on other services to meet additional cost pressures within services. And they vary from council to council, so the cost pressures that are being faced in remote and island ways are probably very different to the type of challenges that we face within Dundee. So I suppose one of the discussions that we've been having through COSLA is around funding for core services, the day-to-day service that we're providing, as well as investing in and delivering new services.
Thanks, Robert. Anybody else? Kirsty?
Yes, so Robert mentioned early years. There's also additional funding has been provided for additional teachers, additional funding for free school meals. And the issue we've got is that funding is given 1 year and then it's never inflated in future years. So then we have to meet the cost of that inflation in future years, and that erodes some of our other core services. And there was discussion earlier on about how much is controllable within local authorities, and that figure becomes smaller when we've got to continue with these paying for the inflationary aspect of these policy initiatives. So we would like, where there is new policy initiatives, for there to be inflation built into that in future years, so it doesn't erode the existing core services.
Thanks. Martin.
And just to add to that, you know, so just as an example, free school meals was funding was provided, but we're all aware of the pressure and the inflationary pressure on food prices from our own domestic shopping bills. That same pressure applies to local authorities in buying the food to deliver those free school meals, but there's no inflationary account taken of it. The other point that Robert made at the start about 1140 hours. 1140 hours was building on an existing policy, so there was already a number of hours provided, but there was no protection to that bit of budget. So that inflationary pressure is actually going back even further than the 1140 hours, and that pay inflation since that was introduced has been quite significant, much higher than previous years, but that's not funded.
Okay, thank you very much for that. I'm now going to bring in Willie Coffey with some questions.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to you. I wonder if I could invite you to dive into the ring fencing swimming pool and offer some perspectives on the discussion that we had earlier. You might have heard Bill saying that the Accounts Commission's estimate was about 23% was ring fenced, and Cosla saying it's about 60%, and the Scottish Government says it's about 7%. Could ask you for your own perspective of where you see those figures, and perhaps offer the committee an explanation of how you arrive at that. Maybe Martin, kick off, please.
Again, it's one of these where everybody's kind of correct, depending on how you interpret it. So I think Bill was quite clear about the sort of legal ring fencing part, which is the bit the Scottish Government are referring to. The other is about direction. So, for example, for the last 3 or 4 years, the Scottish Government has insisted that we provide flat cash to as our contribution to the health and social care partnerships. So for Glasgow, that's just under 30% of our budget is what we spend on social work. If we have to give them flat cash, then that is restricting what we can do with that. So I would argue that 30% is absolutely directed, which is really where you get to Cosla's figure of 60%. It was brought up earlier that last week there was a bit of a change to do with teachers. That's directing spend. So if we're not allowed to change our teaching workforce, then that's directing that spend. So I'd actually argue that if that comes in, that figure is much, much higher than 60%. Because again, 39% of Glasgow spend is on education, of which a very sizable percentage of that is teachers. So when you start to add all these bits together, as well as the funding that comes directly from departments for particular initiatives, you're getting to a very high figure. I would argue well over 70%. But it's down to your interpretation of what's directed and how much flexibility there is around that direction.
Okay, thanks. Thanks, Martin. Kirsty, Robert, any additional perspective on these figures and why they're so variable?
Yeah, I think Martin's explained that very well. But, you know, and I agree. I think we're above the 60%, probably more towards the 70%. So that does mean when we have our budget gap, it's that 30% we're looking at to try and deliver that saving, and that's really challenging because that's the services that mean a lot to the public. I'm not saying education and social work don't either, but you know, you've got your waste, your bins, your leisure facilities, your cultural facilities. So you know, it means that it's a deeper cut for them because that we would consider that the remainder of it to be ring fenced.
Robert, finally.
I just want to highlight some of this is at the heart of where the decision making is for local government. So, you know, we can have an argument about what the percentages are or where the control is. And I suppose from a local government perspective, we will want to see local decision making about the best way to invest, whether it's in teachers or in social care, and where the border is across those. And we've been having a discussion, you know, around what's the balance between support staff in school and teaching staff in school. And that, I would contend, is a local decision that needs to be made locally. So some of that is around what that relationship, and I think that's at the heart perhaps of the question that the New Deal addresses around how do we make decisions that best serve our communities. And you talked a little bit earlier about community empowerment and how are those decisions made at a community level or at a council level or at a governing level so they're achieving the best outcomes. Because I think, you know, just to go back to what I was saying before, what we're achieving in outcomes, I think we're consistent about what we want to get to. It's about what's the best way of understanding those and probably having an open conversation about the best way to achieve them.
OK, Thanks very much for that, Robert. Thanks, Convener. I think I'm coming in after the next question as well. So thank you for that for the moment. Thank you.
Mark Griffin.
Thanks, Convener. I just wanted to talk about in-year transfers from other government portfolios and how they're treated, how they're viewed by local government now. Central government contend that, you know, in-year transfers, they're part of the general rental revenue grant, that councils have absolutely full discretion and autonomy to spend them as they see fit. What is your view of, you know, in-year transfers from other portfolios? What reporting mechanisms are attached to those, and what restrictions are there on how you can use them?
Yes, I think the first point would be, I don't think we've got full discretion of how we spend those. They come with very specific requests. So, for example, in the last year, free school music tuition and not charging for core curriculum charges in education were two policies that came in. We've not got discretion to continue to charge for music tuition. That would have been an issue that individual councils would have had different policies on in the past. Councils would have taken a decision that it may have been the lesser of two evils to charge children for music tuition. That discretion was taken away and it was funded. But these things all come with reporting. So in 2022, there were 77 papers taken to the Settlement and Distribution Group to agree the funding, and that's for generally for departmental transfers to agree the basis of funding and how it was allocated. The year before that, in 2021, there was 93. So that's a lot of individual pots of discretion that generally come with reporting on them. The term that we are often given is, it will be light touch, but it's still reporting. And in an environment where we're under significant financial pressure, we're reducing our staffing, every bit of reporting brings a challenge, because it's the same scarce resource that's having to do all of this. So I would absolutely, I think generally we would agree with the intent, the point that Robert made. I don't think we're miles apart on agreeing what's important, but it's the strings that come with things and the level of direction. I would argue that we should be agreeing strategic priorities. So absolutely, Robert mentioned child poverty. Dealing with child poverty is really, really important. But how best to deal with child poverty will not be the same in Glasgow as it is in Argyll and Bute. And actually giving the flexibility for local authorities to determine the best way to deal with child poverty to meet their local circumstances would be far more powerful.
Can I just add to that as well? I suppose it's the administration burden we've got from all these additional sources of funding that, you know, when we have to do reporting. And Martin mentioned that the number of funds that there are. It was an issue we raised in the Directors of Finance letter to the DFM as well, because, you know, the expectations of the public is that there's still more that we can do in the time of the real financial pressure that local government has. So they see these new services coming online and think local government can still continue providing. That's becoming challenging as well.
Okay, and I guess the ultimate test of whether you've got autonomy or not for these, is there any clawback? So if you decided to continue with charging for music tuition, would the government claw back the funding that they provided for that, or anything else, whether it was free school meals or any other initiative? Can the government claw back that money if you choose not to spend it on where they're asking you to?
I think that's a really topical point with the situation from last week when you know, there was the education situation where the government intended to put some legislation in about pupil teacher ratios, and so whilst government would say we have autonomy over it, if we do then something that is not light. Because I think there's some savings options where were leaked into the public domain from some councils, and then that's why that intervention has came in last week. So it's an interesting question of what real autonomy we have. We did get a letter from the Deputy First Minister at the beginning of November, and it made it quite clear in that letter that we as democratic elected bodies have the freedom to spend our resources, as the decisions that we need for our local circumstances. But whether if we actually put that into practice, that would be allowed. I think it's a test.
Thank you.
Thanks, Mark. Can I bring Willie back in?
Thanks very much again, Convener. I wonder if I can ask you for your perspective on use of reserves and perhaps the three councils that you represent. We heard Bill saying earlier that two-thirds of the councils are planning to deploy some element of their reserves to meet to the requirements in the year ahead. Could you offer a perspective on what your own council's doing and maybe a general perspective on how you see the whole position about reserves and how they should be used and deployed in local government?
Again, I think our colleagues from the Accounts Commission covered this reasonably well in that they explained the difference between kind of earmarked reserves and unearmarked reserves. So quite a lot of our reserves balances are held for a particular purpose, quite often a Scottish Government commitment. Quite often funding comes very late in a financial year and it can't always be spent in year, but it's still to be spent for that purpose. So it's really the unearmarked reserves that we've be focusing on. As Blythe said, every council will have a policy, but Audit Scotland's guidance is between 2-4% of our unearmarked reserves. Obviously, if it's a smaller council, you might be nearer the 4%, whereas a larger council, you get more flexibility and you can be nearer the 2%. Glasgow's policy is 2% of net expenditure. We hover around about that mark most of the time. In the current financial year, we will dip a little bit below that because it's there for resilience, and we've tested resilience this year because of the cost of living and energy and utility inflation particularly. But we will then aim to recover that over the medium term. The use of reserves to balance budgets, I think there's perhaps a little bit of misunderstanding. We certainly wouldn't allow it just to use reserves to balance the figures. It would be where there is a saving that's been put forward that isn't going to deliver its full value in year, then we might use reserves to underpin that. Now, again, you can only use reserves once, so that would be a very difficult decision to take, but practicalities are that we would sometimes use reserves to buy us time for a particular saving to fully deliver. So, for example, if you were taking a saving in education, which operates really on a school year, so from August to June, rather than from April to March, then it's quite often difficult for education to make a saving starting from 1st of April. So you'll get roughly two-thirds of that saving in year. You might use reserves to underpin the other third because you know it's coming. So I would consider that still to be prudent. So I think that's probably the way most councils are using reserves, to just buy them some time over rather than just using cash.
Mm-hmm. And are you one of the two-thirds that will be dipping into some reserves, Mark?
I think historically we've used a little bit of reserves, but we take into account where our reserves balance is. Mm-hmm. That will be more challenging this year because we've just come out of the cost of living the inflationary pressure.
Similar to Martin, I wouldn't advocate the use of reserves for revenue spending, and it's not something that we do. I think sometimes the figures in the national reports, there's maybe sometimes a timing issue. It might be like certainly for COVID, we got quite a lot of money late on in the financial year, and it was not to, it was for things the following year. So whilst that might look like we're drawing in reserves, it's for a particular purpose. I'm not planning to use reserves. The majority of our reserves we build up for to support in our capital programme. And commitments of that nature, rather than use it for recurring revenue expenditure. Okay. And no plans to do that in 2023-24 either.
Thanks, Kirsty. Robert and Dundee, what's the picture in Dundee in relation to reserves?
Well, the Council's not decided what it's doing for next year yet, but a very similar position to what Kirsty and Martin have outlined. What I was going to add was what we have seen and where we will be looking at using our COVID reserves is around where they still haven't recovered from the impact of COVID on the business of, as usual, of the council. So two areas, particularly for us, where income hasn't recovered are around leisure trusts and around car parking, where the reserves that we set aside, we recognised would be needed over a period of time while those built back up, and it remains out as to the extent to which services will recover from COVID. And the only other thing to add is I think we're increasingly facing significant risks around inflation and around cost pressures in year that perhaps over a long period where we had relatively low inflation didn't exist. But where we're talking about a £3 or £4 million increase in energy costs in a year, that makes you think about whether 2%, which for us is just a little over £8 million in the year, is sufficient. So maintaining that sufficient reserves to have resilience and not having to impact on services in the short term is really important. Just one other thing to add, which is indirectly related, is that we're using money from this year to help with energy costs from next year. We're very keen that we protect services, and I think I'm sure all councils are. So we're not looking to making sure we're not cutting services for things that are temporary. And I think, as Martin was describing, money is, we would use balances sometimes to smooth the impact of something. So we provide the best services we can, and we manage change effectively.
Okay. Thanks very much for that, Robert. My last question to you is on the funding formula, just to get your perspective on whether the funding formula is correct, appropriate, needs adjusted or otherwise. And there's a huge amount of debate about it. And some of the figures that we have in front of us today show that, I mean, Aberdeen City and Edinburgh get the smallest per head settlement in Scotland. But if you look at the real terms changes to the revenue allocations, Aberdeen's at the top. Getting 7.2% in the Scottish average is 3%. So there's a whole set of variables in the funding formula. Just maybe to ask for your perspective on the funding formula. Are we happy and content with it? I suppose the answer to that will be no, but does it need to be adjusted, and is it a fair way of allocating resources to Scotland's councils?
I think the first thing I'd say is we wouldn't like to comment on any individual council. We're kind of representing all 32 as best as we can. And there is differences. I think the argument is that there's a number of things that influence the costs of providing council services. Population and the demographics of that population is clearly one of them. I think the others are to do with rurality, so the kind of super sparsity thing, that it costs more to collect a bin that's 2 miles away from the next bin than one that's next door to the next bin, and deprivation. So I think there'll be a number of other factors, but I think they're probably the headline ones, that providing services to rural and deprived communities influences that demographic or population allocation. We have a system in place. I don't think anyone would claim that system was perfect, but at the precise moment in time, it's probably the best we've got. Making changes to that in a time of austerity, in a time of reducing costs, I think would potentially be devastating to some of our local authorities. And while I would argue that all of the local authorities are on a knife edge as regards financial sustainability, I think changing the funding formula when we're in that position would be impossible for some authorities. In an ideal world, you would start to change that formula when you've got a growing pot, so that in reality, those that you would argue are overfunded, and be very cautious with saying that, would have lower increases, and those that were, where their population was growing or where their circumstance would change, would have a bigger increase, and that's how you do it. But it's been a long time since we've been in that position. I am old enough to remember when there's growth options in our budget every year, but most of my colleagues don't remember that.
I can remember it, Martin. Thanks. Thank you very much for that perspective. Kirsty?
Nothing to add from what Martin said there. I fully agree.
Happy with the funding formula that's in place?
I think we've got a formula that, as Martin says, it's not perfect, but it's the best we've got at this moment in time. And until we have a move on the quantum in an upwards direction, I don't think we could revisit that at this moment in time.
OK, thank you. Robert Dundee's perspective on the funding formula, is it right? Does it need adjusted?
Thank you. Apologies. It's imperfect, and I think that it's very complex. So I think it's really important to remember, I suppose, local government delivers a whole range of different services and in different ways to suit historic decisions that have been made and policy decisions that have been made that suit their own local circumstances. So it is always going to be complicated. The point I'd like to just draw out is that one of the things that I think most directors of finance would say is stability is really important. And the floor mechanism that's within the distribution that provides a stability over the piece means that there aren't sudden shifts which could have devastating effects on individual services. And if you look at where the biggest elements of the floor are and the impact of removing those from some of those size councils, it will be devastating to say we're just going to change the picture. It needs planning. And I think, as Kirsty was aligned to, the floor would eventually grow out if the budget was growing, but it's not. And that represents a challenge for us. So I would submit that at the present time, not looking at the distribution is not the thing to do. We should be looking at what fiscal flexibilities we've got to try and grow the resource to support what we're trying to do in local government, and that will be a better focus of our time at the moment. Though I think it's fair to say not every director of finance would necessarily agree.
Okay, thanks very much for that, everybody. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Willie. I'm now going to bring in Paul McLennan.
I think, Robert, you just kind of set me up for the next question, because one of them is moving on to revenue-raising options that are open to councils at the moment. And I think you've maybe all been present in the last panel where I kind of asked a question around about both in short term but also longer term. And Carol Calder mentioned about general competence, about councils having the ability to raise funds. So I wonder if you can comment on just saying what's available at the moment, what's preventing you doing that at the moment? And probably looking more medium term, I think we mentioned at the last panel that most local authorities, for example, in Europe have the ability to raise about 50% of their own income. In Scotland, it's about 15-ish. So again, it's maybe looking short term, what would you like to see and what prevents you? And medium to longer term, what other powers do you think the local authorities could be looking at in terms of that? You mentioned about local sales. I'm not proposing these are what are in other countries, local sales tax and so on, roof taxes and other visits to hotels, all that kind of stuff in terms of that. So I just wonder if you can comment on that. And I'll probably come to yourself, Robert, just in terms of that. First of all, you just can mention about fiscal flexibilities and then go to the two others.
Apologies. Yeah. Thank you. So just to look at a couple of areas, I suppose. Firstly, think about fees and charges that that councils can levy. And I think that there's two aspects I'd like to draw attention to. One is, I think there's a natural limit, particularly in a time of a cost of living crisis, about what we can charge for services and the delivery of services. So, you know, we've been having discussions about, you know, what can you charge for car parking and what income will you raise and where does the demand and price point sit? And I would suggest at the moment that's limited. The ability to raise prices and find that people respond and pay higher prices and generate significant income in that way, I think, is probably limited. I think as councils, we'd like to see control over things like planning fees and things that they're paying for services sitting with councils. So we make our own decisions about what we levy, and that reflects what those costs are. And that picture varies across the country in terms of the demand for services and the types of services that are delivered. Council tax, I suppose, is a whole subject area which you can get into, and it's not a perfect system. It's a well understood system by the public in terms of tax raising powers. I think most councils use the flexibilities that are within it around empty homes and things and second homes. I would submit there are areas where councils could have more flexibility and you know, to look at additional charges for empty homes, particularly if you think of the significant shortage of housing and the fact houses are sitting empty, then the more levers we've got to help us with that type of thing that's important. But I also think there's a real challenge around council tax in terms of valuing the base, and there's a quick win, I think, in the system, for example, in terms of revaluing a house if it's extended or enlarged or whatever, or improved to an extent that it will put it into a different band on that. The last thing I can touch on, if I may, briefly, is about rates, because my view would be that having different poundage rates across Scotland would be at risk of creating a competition on something that wasn't necessary. But I think rates can be a huge driver of economic activity, and one of the things we're grappling with is how do we keep city centres alive and how do we keep shopping precincts and retail alive and provide it with the maximum support. So rates is a hugely powerful thing. So I think we welcome the devolution of unoccupied property Brent, but I suppose I would contend that if we're local government and we've got devolved powers to do our things, then decisions about that should sit at the most appropriate local level for making sure you can influence what happens in your area, because that all supports economic growth. I suppose, just to go back to my point on poundage, what we don't want is competition. I don't want to be competing with nearby councils on economic growth. I want to be working collaboratively.
Robert, thank you for that. Martin, I'll probably come to yourself, or Kirsty, whoever wants to come in first. And again, it's maybe looking at the medium to long term as well, if you have any thoughts on that.
Yeah, I think just to add to Robert's point, I think, first of all, fees and charges in lots of cases, and I'd exclude the example Robert gave in planning, but in lots of cases, we're the provider of last resort. We're not providing services to wealthier individuals. We're providing services to some of the poorest and most vulnerable in our society. So our ability to raise charges, I think, is severely restricted by that. I think some of the other things that have been talked about just now, like workplace parking levies and visitor levies, they're not game changers. They're not going to fundamentally change the position for councils. Some councils will gain nothing out of a visitor levy because they haven't got a big tourist population. In other authorities, it will make a significant help. But again, you know, so if Glasgow gets about 3 million visitors, if that's £2 a night, it might be £6 million. We're in a £1.8 billion net budget. So it is helpful, but it's in the roundings. I think looking towards the medium term, I think for a locally democratic organisation to be only raising, in Glasgow's case, about 12% of its net budget comes from council tax, that doesn't tie in with local accountability. So there has to be a fundamental review of the base of that revenue-raising powers. And if that involves looking at local income taxes, local sales taxes, all of the other things that happen in other places of the world, I think that has to be part of that medium-term
Martin,
discussion.
I suppose putting your SIPFA hat on as well. Is that something that SIPFA have, or Director of Finance have discussed at this stage?
Robert's our representative on the fiscal framework work, so Robert would be leading on that. But it's something that's been discussed over a number of years, but it's not progressed. I think changing council tax has probably been higher up the agenda. Yeah. But again, it's how you can change that where it fundamentally changes the funding position.
Okay. I'll maybe bring Robert back in at the end of this just to see if he has any comments on that one. But Kirsty, anything just on yourself on that?
No, Martin mentioned the visitor levy in Argyll and Bute. That's obviously something that would give us significant revenue. So, but you know, unfortunately, there's a process to go through and then a lead-in time before that's brought in. I think the lead-in time's probably a bit on the long side. I think it's deemed to be 18-month lead-in time from when you acknowledge you're going to use it. And I think in Europe, things like that have come in 6 months rather than 18 months. Again, it'll be interesting to see how we're restricted in spending that funding, because some of it will probably need to go towards existing resources that would otherwise have to cease because of funding cuts. So I think it's to be used for additionality for tourism.
There's a well-being legislation that kind of wraps around it, that as well, how it's raised and how it's in proportion.
Yeah, but we need to just see kind of what additionality means, because there'll be some services that we might want to continue to provide which we can't, so therefore they should be deemed as additional. Yeah. But that'll be significant revenue for us in Argyll and Bute, should members choose to adopt it.
Kirsty, thanks for that. Robert, just coming back to the point about the fiscal, you know, the fiscal discussions that are going on around about obviously looking in the medium long term. I don't know, have there been discussions held at that within that group on the medium to long term things that we're talking about, local sales tax, for example?
So yes, we haven't talked about local sales tax, but we have talked about what are the measures that could come in and what would be the process for bringing in measures to look at them. Kirsty makes a very good point about the time frame to respond to these things, but also the fact that, I mean, visitor tax is a good one, where there are costs associated with visitors and the income is probably likely to coincide with the costs of managing and looking after visitors in rural areas. But I think what we need is a process that is fleet of foot, and we've had a discussion about that. How do we produce a process that works, but also how do we make sure that we produce a process that doesn't cut across other initiatives and other policies. So if we're trying to, for example, if you were trying to encourage visitors, what would that mean? If you increased a visitor tax, and what would that have? What's the wider economic benefit? So there's a real focus on making sure there is no unintended consequences of those things. But there are the particular things that we are looking, thinking about is what can you do with council tax? What can you do with rates? What can you do with any other levies that you can raise and who you can raise them on? There isn't a huge number of ideas, if I'm honest, of other things that people have thought of. So obviously interested in any ideas people have got. And there's also that weighing up the burden of bureaucracy and the cost of administering a tax versus what you're going to raise and how you're going to manage it, which is, of course, one of the challenges around the visitor levy is how do you levy it? How do you collect it? What's the cost of administering it? Which is, of course, one of the advantages of council tax, that it's collectible and we know where everyone is.
Thanks, Chair. I think the second question has kind of been answered, wrapped up in that. Yep. So
thank you, Paul. We're now going to bring in Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. And I was interested with the line of questioning Paul had there with regards to the fiscal framework and, you know, flexibilities which have been called for. So I just wondered, in terms of that, how you would see funding rules and agreements between local and central government around that changing to provide that flexibility? You touched earlier, Kirsty, in terms of what government say, in terms of you having the right to decide your local priorities and spend, but it's clear that's not then the case when there's policy commitments, which are only, you know, you've got to deliver.
Possibly a joint conversation about delivering on the outcomes. I think there's quite a lot of focus on inputs rather than what we can deliver jointly. That's one area I think we could work together, because I think I don't know whether it was Robert earlier or somebody in the earlier session had said that, you know, a lot of what we're trying to do in Scottish Government are trying to do and what local government are trying to do is quite similar. So if we could just get together and, you know, and not have that focus on inputs, I think that would be helpful.
Just to expand on that point, Robert had mentioned earlier about, you know, classroom assistance. So if our objective is to improve attainment in our schools, which I think, again, is something that everybody agrees that we would want our children to do as well as they possibly can, and to improve attainment, in lots of authorities, they have worked to improve attainment by introducing classroom assistance to spread the burden of teaching and be able to teach in different ways by imposing limits on the number of teachers. That might take away that flexibility and take you down a very specific route. So number of teachers is an input, it's not an outcome. And really, Scottish Government's commitment should be on strategic objectives and outcomes and not on inputs.
Thanks, Robert. Did you want to come in on this as you're leading?
I think this comes back to, and one of the things that we're trying to introduce through the work on the fiscal framework is a transparent dialogue. So we're looking to try and produce data for the government to have a look at earlier in the year when it's starting to develop plans about what's happening in local government, what are the cost pressures we're facing in local government, what are the services we're trying to deliver, so that it's a transparent conversation. I think there's always going to be some tension between what might be national priorities and what might be local priorities and how you might choose to manage those. So I think that we need to just accept that we need to work together in an open way. And I really want to just emphasise what Kirsty was saying, is we need to be thinking about what we're achieving. So our discussion should be about attainment. Are we achieving attainment? Are we achieving positive destinations for our children leaving our schools? They're the measures that I think we should be looking to be accountable for, and we should be looking to deliver on. How much are we growing the economy? What are we going to grow the economy? How are we supporting the objectives? Not measuring what's going in, because that implies that there's no room for efficiency in how things are done, and there's always a bit of scope to do things better and differently, and it's important that we're not embedding the same way of doing things, but we're looking at can we be a bit smarter in all of the things that we do.
Thank you for that, and I think that's where looking back to the historic Concord Act, which government used to talk about, is there a model which we've already tried, but which has been around freezing council tax previously, not about necessarily more income for councils to raise, which could be picked up, which councils have signed up to previously, which you think would work to provide that flexibility at a local level, which everyone's telling us they want to see, but also that national accountability around outcomes?
I should probably hold my hands up here and say I actually wrote the Concordat along with a civil servant when I worked at COSLA 15, 16 years ago. I think the key things that were within the Concordat, to my mind, were one of them was a reduction in ring fencing. Mm-hmm. So legal ring fencing has reduced since then. There was a significant move at that time. But what happened, it's been replaced with that direction. The other big thing was that there would be a view to increasing or protecting and increasing local government share of the Scottish Government budget. That clearly hasn't happened. Now, that's because there's been a significant increase in health spend in that time frame. And I don't think any of us are suggesting there shouldn't be, but maybe the focus again is too much on inputs and not enough on outputs, and that focus should be on health and wellbeing rather than just the NHS. Health is a much wider thing. So I think some of the sentiments of the Concordat were very positive. I think we've probably lost sight of them over the years.
Yeah, thank you. Anyone else want to comment on that point? No, otherwise, hand back to you, Convener. Thank you.
I'm going to move to Annie Wells online. Annie, are you there?
I am, Convener. Brilliant. Thank you, and good morning, panel. This is a question for each of you, and it's basically what progress has been made in your local authorities towards more use of the participatory budgeting, and how much more budget and service decisions do you think could be devolved to local areas?
I can kick off. I would probably say there's maybe been limited use of kind of what the kind of historic definition of participatory budgeting was. We did do it for our third sector grants, which is a small element of our budget, but it was proved that the administrative burden of doing that it wasn't really cost effective, and I think participatory budgeting works fairly well if you've got a distinct pot of money, but with the reducing resources. Many councils don't have a distinct pot of money that you can put aside to kind of do that real participatory budgeting. So we are looking whether we can involve our communities more in some localisation of some services. Maybe limited in what we've actually managed to do in participatory budgeting to date.
Kirsty's comments about it is a really difficult thing to do. We did a number of pilots on participatory budgeting to really test how we'd engaged and how much support we needed to give to communities in some circumstances to be able to do that. We do it's the Glasgow Communities Fund, which is a fairly sizeable amount of money, maybe not a massive percentage of the council's budget, which is our grants to the third and voluntary sector. And we've developed that process on each three-year cycle to be more engaged and more participative. But it's massively over. The demand is way beyond what we can afford. So that brings challenges as well. I think the real issue around full participatory budgeting, which is where you take exactly how you're going to deliver services, is really, really difficult in a time when you're making cuts. I feel really sorry for our elected members who were all elected to represent their local communities, to do good, to make their communities better. And they're now overseeing a series of cuts. That's not what they were really come into election for. And the same argument applies to our local community. To ask people, where you want to cut, it's quite a difficult thing to do, and we have to balance the budgets. So again, in a period of growth where if you're expanding services, that becomes a much easier task. But when you're making cuts, it does feel very challenging. As part of our budget process in Glasgow, we do a public consultation. We use Ipsos to randomly select participants so that they reflect the city on all the different kind of factors. Thankfully, we were back in person for most of them this year, whereas the last couple of years have been online. So it was far more engaging. But again, you're asking people, you know, what they want to protect. So it's a difficult ask. It's not about where you'd like investment. I think we can make progress, but we need to get the quantum sorted first.
Robert, did you want to come in on that?
Thanks, Martin.
Thank you. Just to add to that, I suppose, I mean, we've still got some good examples. We're doing a piece of work around a climate change participatory budgeting piece at the moment, but it is, labour intensive, and part of that is to make sure that it's not that we reach out to everyone we need to reach out, and there aren't excluded groups in the work that's going on there. But that's working largely with areas where we have discretionary spend. And I suppose my concern is discretionary spend will reduce if we're under more financial pressure in future years. I think there is also a tension around, you know, we've got local elected members who are familiar with their communities. They'll know what the issues are. They will tell you that the issues that people will come to them are around potholes and bins and dog waste. You know, there are things that will come forward. And I think, as Martin was saying, I think if we're coming to a discussion that says, would you rather have your grass cut or your potholes filled or a teacher, then who's making that decision? And where does that sit with national policy? And all that conversation needs to be transparent, because we need to make sure we're responding to community needs. And my concern is that if resources become scarcer or we focus them on different priorities, we're going to pull in from some of those areas which are really important to communities. And that's where I think the voice of local elected members is really important, of being on the ground. And for those of you that have been elected, local elected representatives, you'll know about the issues that come forward all of the time. So I think it is a challenge, and I suppose in my mind it's something we need to continue to work out. The last thing I'd just say is COVID has made us take a step back. I think all of that consultative and engagement stuff is much easier in person than it is trying to do it online.
Thanks very much for your answers. I've just got one final question. Given that councils do have the flexibility to increase council tax in 2023-24, could I ask what processes and assessments do councils go through to make sure that the increases are proportionate and fair to households across their local authority areas?
Kirsty?
I think that's quite a difficult question, certainly I would feel, for me to answer, because the setting of council tax is very much a member decision, and also the setting of council tax should actually be the balancing entry to help to balance your budget. But within, you know, the current cost of living crisis, I think members are very mindful of the challenges that individuals face in meeting ends meet. I think there's a balance, a consideration that members have got to take about how much people can afford against how much we really need to raise. And I think Martin had mentioned earlier that the council tax figure for his council was around about 12%. If your overall budget, we are a bit higher than that in Argyll and Bute, to balance the budgets with the challenges that we're facing would mean you would have to raise council tax by quite a significant amount, and that would be unpalatable for local members and also for the general public. So it's a difficult one for me to answer.
I think our elected members are very aware of the cost of the living crisis and the impact that's having in local communities. So they're very cognizant of the need for constraint, but they're also cognizant of the need to balance the budget and therefore to have potentially council tax increases. It is a political decision. I think from an equity point of view, you could argue how fair council tax is, how much the value of your property reflects your wealth. In some people, it's probably a good measure, but we know for certain members of our society, it's not a good measure. And we could all give examples of people living in big houses with low income. There is council tax reduction that will help, but I don't think that truly makes it a fair tax, but I think it helps for the most extreme cases.
Thank you. Robert, did you want to come in?
Just briefly, Convener, just to add that I think when we put the information to members to make that decision, then we provide them with the context they're making it in. So they're looking at what the cost of living rise is. They are looking at feedback from the budget consultation we've done and what the public have got to say about it. And they're looking at the other measures that they're putting in the budget that might be to alleviate cost of living pressures. So I can't speak for next year, but for example, last year we allocated additional money to help with fuel poverty and to help with food supply in the local community. So the council tax decision is not taken in isolation of the other decisions that are made as part of the budget that we are setting.
Thank you very much for your answers, and thank you, Convener.
Thanks, Annie. I'm going to bring in Mark Griffin.
Thanks, Convener. I'll ask questions, kind of an academic question, and that, you know, directors of finance have been very clear about the gap in the budget from what they are facing in terms of demands and what central government is providing. What figure can you put on what you would need to increase council tax in each of your authorities to make up that shortfall?
I think Kirsty kind of covered that slightly the last time, in that the figure we'd need to put council tax up with to close the gap would just be unaffordable. I can quote figures from Glasgow because they're in the public domain, because they've been to council committees. So my first financial forecast had a gap of £120 million, predominantly driven by inflationary increases through pay, through utilities, and pay for this year and for next year, and based on assumptions of what that pay increase will be. 1% of council taxes, net of council tax reduction, is about £2.4 million. So that's a 50% increase in council tax. Since then, I've done an updated forecast, which took the figure down to £70 million. That sounds like a massive increase, but that was following the direction that social work had to get flat cash. So we don't give them any of their pressures, but we don't take any savings. So it was £70 million from 70% of the council, as opposed to 100% of the council. But again, £70 million, £2.4 million, that's not an achievable figure. It has to be, it's one of the tools in the box as part of the budget balancing exercise, so we need to take significant cuts as well. After sort of 10 years of cuts, there's some efficiencies in there, but a significant element of it are cuts, so there are reductions in service, but it would not be possible to balance that with council tax.
Yeah, no, I know that it's something that would never be imposed, but that's why I'm saying it. You know, the question's academic, but I'm still interested to know what the level of increase would need to be to cover it.
So if we didn't take any savings and if we included social work in Glasgow, it would be 50%.
OK, thank you. Kirsty?
That gave me time to do the calculations for Argyll and Bute there again. But as Robert made the point and Martin made the point, it's one of the tools in the toolbox. We would never look at it in isolation. But for us, our gap is around about 12 million. And half a million, every 1% of council tax raises approximately half a million. So, you know, we would have to raise council tax by 22, 23, 24% in isolation. And as I say, that isn't something you would consider.
OK, thanks. And Robert?
So on the same basis, if you look at what we put forward in January and we had a budget gap of 14.3 million, then it's about 23%, I think, you'd have to put council tax up. How do you describe it, an academic sense? Obviously, we're looking at how else we might bridge that gap, because that's clearly not a tenable position to be in.
OK, thank you. Thanks, Kimina.
Thanks, Mark. I just wanted to ask, I think it might be the final question. In the previous panel, I was talking to Bill Moyes about his statement around the need for council to focus more on service reform to find the safe path through difficult times ahead. And I'd just be interested to hear, when you hear that reform, I asked for specifics before, but maybe you've got some thoughts about that that would help me understand what he's getting at there. Martin, you've been nodding your head.
Yep, we did hear that question earlier and we did react. I think to say that there's not been reform in local government is inaccurate and unfair. I think there's some big headline things. So the creation of the Health and Social Care Partnerships was a reform to try to deliver services better and to work much closer with our
colleagues from health. We've all had significant channel shift in how we deliver services. No longer do people queue up to pay their rent or their council tax in a cash office. We've moved things online. We've changed how we deliver services. But just a couple of examples of services that have evolved over time. I think we've probably gone for, you know, evolution rather than revolution. So, you know, we used to have single bins that were maybe, you know, steel bins that refuse collectors would lift and empty into the back of a refuse collection. That moved to wheel bins, which were much better from an environmental point of view because they capture things better. We now have multiple wheel bins and other types of containers so that we reduce landfill and we collect different types of recyclate in different things. And that's a continuing. Mm-hmm. Glasgow with four bins at the moment. We had a paper at our city administration committee just last week that's proposing an introduction of a fifth bin to further refine or recycle it to make it more recyclable. Likewise, libraries used to give out books and that was all they used to do. Now, if you go into a library, you can go in there to access the internet, to get training on IT and other things. We provide employment support advice in libraries. We provide benefits advice, particularly with the rollout of Universal Credit. Libraries had a key role to play in that. Our Improving the Cancer Journey service and other long-term conditions support service is all delivered through libraries, and they still give out books as well. So that service has massively transformed over the last sort of 20 years and completely provides a completely different service. Still does books as well.
That's great to hear that it still does books, but also there's a whole idea of stacking functions in a building and a space that's open to the public. Anyway, Kirsty, you got
it. So Martin's given some examples of reform, but we have to remember that sometimes reform doesn't generate necessarily a saving. So some reform it comes at a cost. And I'm just thinking, too, that we're faced with in Argyll and Bute Council at the moment. One is to do with the introduction of the BMW ban in 2025, and that comes with a significant pressure for us to deliver that. So I think that's service reform from a Scottish Government perspective, but it comes at a significant capital and revenue cost for Argyll and Bute Council. There is also the move for the smaller vehicles will no longer be petrol or diesel from 2025, and I had a paper across my desk last week, and for us to replace all our small vehicles within the council's £9.5 million. Now, to put that into context, that's the level of our capital grant in 1 year. So for us to replace all our fleet, we would have to use in 1 year all our capital grant. So that means you would not be doing any capital works in any of your schools or any of your other buildings. So you know, we have done lots of reform, but it was just a word of caution that some reform comes with additional cost as well.
Robert, what about in Dundee?
So I think I'm thoughtful about the fact that we've already gone through a significant reform programme. I think that when you think about frontline services, once you've got them running efficiently, then there isn't a huge amount to do except to do less of them. And so if you think about the waste collection and the people out collecting the waste and the people providing good direct care services and the people teaching in schools and providing direct services. So I think there's always more we can do. We can always go a bit further. And I think there are still some collaborative approaches, but they're not significant in terms of the core frontline delivery that we're providing. And one of the things we haven't talked about today is capital. So if you think about roads in particular, which I know is a key issue for many citizens, then what we are spending on roads is not going up. And then that means the condition of our roads in the long term is not going to continue. But capital isn't either. And therefore, you know, we're looking at a new school at the moment, and the impact of inflation on the back of COVID and Brexit and the war in Ukraine is significant in terms of the cost of delivering capital infrastructure in the future. And I think that's an area where we are going to be under increasing pressure in the future, just because of the cost of doing things and the scarce resources in the system to actually do things. So some of our reform has been about standing still in terms of doing the same amount for the same resources. So the work that we've done with KSAG contracts around uniform approaches to roads related work across Tayside, has moved us on to a certain extent, but it will only deliver so many efficiencies. And then it's a question of how much money have you got and how much road repairs, for example, can you do with the resources that are available to you. So there are still challenges, and local government, I think, has been successful in addressing some of those challenges over those years. And you know, colleagues like myself will continue to be saying, how can we get the best value for the public sector as we go forward into the next year?
Thanks very much for that. And thanks for bringing in the piece about capital. I said that was the last question, but does anyone else want to come in with anything we might not have covered that you feel like we really need to hear?
I think Robert's point about capitals is well made. That's an area that we're seeing significant challenges in the cost of providing capital projects, and the capital grant figure is not going up. You know, on the back of COVID and trying to put some more money into our communities to boost the economy there, it's really challenging. And some councils, I know, are having to cut back some of their capital projects to meet the inflation demand. I think in some areas you're seeing a 30% or more increase in construction costs for capital projects, and that's a real challenge for councils.
Thank you. Martin, anything else to add? No.
No, thanks.
Okay, super. Well, thank you all for coming and bringing your evidence for us today. And I now briefly suspend the meeting while our witnesses leave the room. Thank you. The final public item on our agenda today is to consider a negative instrument, the Valuation Proposals Procedure Scotland Regulations 2022. Do members have any comments on the instrument? No comments. Is the committee agreed that we do not wish to make any recommendations in relation to this instrument? We are all agreed. Thank you. We agreed at the start of the meeting to take the next two items in private, so as that was the last public item on our agenda today, I now close the public part of the meeting.